Let's recap what we've learned. If we started with a normal distribution, or if your sample size is large enough, how large is large enough? We don't want to argue about that, so we're going to come up with a rule that everyone's going to agree to. The rule is going to be 30, and I should actually put equals, although I worked really, really hard in this class to make sure it never actually hits 30, because 30 is kind of borderline. So if our sample size is large enough, over 30, or if x is normal, then we can talk about the average in terms of a normal distribution, okay? The normal distribution centered at mu, which is what we expect it should be centered at. But this part is skinnier. This isn't just sigma, it's sigma over the square root of n. We're supposed to put variance right here for notation, so that's why it's sigma squared over n. But sigma over the square root of n is our standard deviation. So this guy is a very powerful thing. This comes from the central limit theorem. And what I just showed you with that applet is how the central limit, I can't spell and write at the same time. Pause. Turns out theorem is a very difficult word to write when you're monologuing. Central limit theorem. So I showed you with a picture how it seems to look normalish. Central limit theorem actually says the math behind it is right. You can get away with this. So if your sample size is large enough, then it approaches a normal distribution, or if it was normal to start with. Let's cover some important vocabulary real quick because it's easy to get this confused. If we were talking about an x, a single person, one observation, instead of talking about an average, we were only talking about one, then sigma, or sigma squared if we were doing variance, would be what we were interested in. Sigma is the standard deviation of x. But this whole thing is related to x bar. So sigma over the square root of n, you could call it the standard deviation of x bar, but that's confusing. You have a standard deviation for x and a standard deviation for x bar. So we like to call this the standard error of x bar. And that way, when I talk about standard deviation, I'm talking about one observation. If I talk about standard error, I'm talking about the error for the average. And that way it helps keep it straight. So what's the point here? The point is, if you know mu, and you know sigma, and you know n, then you can talk about the kinds of x bars you should be getting. I should get an x bar somewhere in this range, close to mu. Or maybe I'll get an x bar just a little bit further away. I might even get an x bar clear out here. What happens if I did a study and I knew mu, sigma, and n, but then I got an x bar way out there? Oh, that should not have happened. It tells me something is wrong. Either I did my survey wrong, but if I did the survey, of course I know I did it right. Or it turns out I don't know mu as well as I thought I did. And that's where we're going to go with this.